Good morning, folks. Welcome back to another video. And today, the topic is, what are the best appliances for an off-grid solar system that draw very low power and are reliable and work as they're supposed to? So a little bit of history here. I really did a lot of research even before I moved off-grid. And one of the things that I discovered right away is you're going to have to be really careful about what appliances you purchase as far as the volts that they draw. So they can be 110, 120, and that's fine. But some homes have 240 volt appliances that just will not work with a solar setup like mine. My building is not wired. It's still technically a shed. So essentially, I just run extension cords into a pretty serious surge protector. So you can see with this system, I have my router plugged in and my computer and the monitor and the lights equaling just a pole lamp. And then also I acquired a toaster oven, and we'll go into that in a bit. And then of course, the refrigerator as well, which I've unplugged just temporarily for this demonstration. And that surge protector power bar is plugged in here. And the good thing about the Titan, there's 6 3-prong plugs where you can plug things in. So when I first moved onto my property, I was in a tent for just not a long time, but of course that meant I could only have canned foods and things that wouldn't spoil. January of 2021, I got this wonderful refrigerator. I got this from Home Depot, and it's called a Galanz, and it's kind of a retro style. It's got the old style handles that actually we had when I was a kid, and of course that was a while ago. So I actually really like the looks of it. So I'm going to go into all the pluses and minuses so you can figure out whether this would be helpful for you as well. But I will just start by telling you it was a game changer for my diet. Now I could have frozen food and vegetables and fresh fruit. Absolutely super. So I special ordered this at Home Depot. Didn't take very long to come. And it looks like now they've dropped about $100 or so in price. So that's a good thing. It weighs about 100 pounds. And it's on wheels, and it actually rolls pretty easy. And for the temperature control, it's interesting. A lot of refrigerators have numbers, you know, from 0 to 10 or whatever. This just has cold or colder. So I just figured out by trial and error. I set it, and I've left it alone, and it's worked really well. So it's going to be a hot day, so I'm going to put some ice cubes in here. It doesn't have an ice maker, but I really don't need one of those. And the lower section's really spacious, tall enough for milk jugs and cartons, and really ample size crisper here. I will say one thing about the crisper, for people that aren't very gentle, it tends to break pretty easy. So I'll glue this, but I tend to be a little too rough sometimes. So let's look at some of the negatives and positives with this refrigerator. Then one negative would be, although it's relatively well constructed, plastic is plastic. And this is not your grandparents' refrigerator. It's nowhere near as sturdy. So keep that in mind. Handle it gently and it should be totally fine. The other thing I learned the hard way, I saw smudges and dirt on this refrigerator. I thought, okay, well, no worries. I grabbed Windex and a paper towel. Well, you can't see because it's over on the other side against the wall. Oh, wow, what a mess. And scratched. This finish is very, very temperamental. But I learned, again, knowledge is power. Use a fiber cloth. And it'll work great, and you won't scratch the refrigerator as well. So let's look at some of the pluses of this refrigerator. overall, I've found it works extremely well and reliable. No fluctuation changes. The freezer part is nice and frost-free and stays this way. For a smaller design refrigerator, lots and lots of room, certainly adequate for me, a single person living in a tiny cabin. So you can imagine, before I even purchased this, I wanted to know, how many watts does this draw? So currently, what's plugged in, folks, is a computer, a monitor, and a router. And I'm charging a camera battery, which is insignificant. And what we're drawing is around 82 watts. And I'm going to interject really quickly and say, I absolutely love this solar generator. I have 4,000 watts of power available to me. It's at 100% charged from my solar array. It's usually 100% charged by 9:30 in the morning. It has more than enough power that I need. Really love this. So if you're interested in the Titan, I'm going to put some links below so that you can learn more how I have this all set up. So now I'm going to plug in the refrigerator and let's see what happens with the draw. Instead of drawing 82, 83 watts, that's going to change. So now that the refrigerator has been fully powered up and has stabilized and everything is being frozen and kept cool, then you can see here that the Titan now is only drawing 148 watts. And that means that this Galan's refrigerator draws very little power and is a total winner for off-grid living. So I'm just delighted with it. I would buy another one at the drop of a hat. So when you're off-grid and you don't have electricity yet, as in when I didn't have any solar set up at all, it's interesting the things that you really miss. For me, it was toast. I really missed having toast in the morning. So now I can do that. So let's get it going. So this super expensive toaster is a vintage model that cost me hundreds of dollars. But you know, I figured it was worth it. No, it was $3 at the thrift store of Bisbee. Now that the toast is cooking, what I really want to know is, how much power is this drawing? So let's go back to the Titan and check it out. So again, with computer, monitor, router, and refrigerator plugged in, we're drawing about 133 watts. So let's go ahead and make some toast and see what happens. So now you can see a big change. Now the toaster has amped that up, and so now we're drawing around a little over 900 watts, and so not bad at all. So I was badly needing an oven. I was thinking of doing a solar oven, but those are pretty pricey. So instead, I opted for this Black & Decker toaster oven, and I absolutely love it. Rather than boiling fish and chicken and stuff, I can now broil it. So let's put this chicken in and get this going. So it's a pretty small oven. You couldn't put a big chicken in there or a turkey or anything. That's okay. So I put the top dial on broil and then the middle one also on broil. I set the timer for about 20 minutes. So the big thing I want to know is, how many watts does it take to broil my chicken meal? And according to this, it's drawing about 744 watts off the Titan. So it looks like we're broiling away here, which is great. Another thing I wanted to show you folks, which is really cool, is I didn't have a lot of room here to put this toaster oven. And what I notice is the bottom of this gets really hot. And I couldn't imagine putting that on a wooden shelf. Looked kind of dangerous. So what I did is I took these unistruts from my solar array setup, and they were already cut to size nicely. And I made a couple shelves here with 2x6 and bolted this to the wall using timber lock screws. And so it's really good and sturdy, and I don't have to worry about the bottom of this getting too hot. So according to the spec sheet, this Black & Decker toaster oven draws about 1150 watts, but the beauty of this is, according to everything that I've seen, at least on broil, it doesn't draw anywhere near that. So although my Titan power generator can only bring in 2,000 watts at a time, we've got 8 340-watt panels here. So that means essentially then those 2,000-watt lithium-ion batteries can just store all the power I need for the day and then some. So this is an inductive cooktop, and I really grown to love this thing. It has a few quirks. You have to use the specific types of pots and pans that work with it, as in steel only, no Teflon type pans, but that's okay. I have steel pans, and so really love this. So let's get some vegetables started to go with the chicken. Put them in the pot. Put the cover on. So first thing you do is push the on and off button. Then it says function. Shows you can put it on a timer, but I never use that. And you might not be able to see it, but it's showing 5.0 is the setting. But to take it easy on my solar system, I'm going to reduce that. 3.5 will be fine. And this is really effective. The water boils pretty fast. So on that setting, not a big deal, 878 watts. So it seemed like it was taking the water a little while to boil, so I cranked it up a few more settings, and now it's drawing 1.1 kilowatts, or 1100 watts. Okay, it looks like we're good. That much closer to dinner. So we can turn this off. One really important thing, of course, is with the Titan system or any system, you're going to have to be careful with the number of appliances you have. It's good to have them under 1100 watts, but that's going to add up if you're running a lot of them at once. So for example, if I was running my cooktop and also my toaster oven and then decided to plug in a microwave if I had it, then that would have overloaded my system. Now, I know that some solar systems are set up to be a lot more powerful than mine, but obviously they cost more too. So to combat all of that for cooking, when I have a 4-burner stove with an oven, that's going to be propane. So that means there won't be any point in my home where everything can't balance in a way that it's not drawing too much power. Well, I hope you enjoyed this video, folks, and if you did, give it a thumbs up. And also, if you haven't subscribed, please subscribe. Lots more videos coming. And also, ring the notification bell thing, and we'll see you on the next video. Thanks so much for joining me here.